Yes, so thank you for introducing me and thank the organizers for the opportunity to give this talk. This is, so I joined work with my former PhD student, Jan Wysoki, who you may have already met somewhere. Okay, so what I will talk about is the effective actions of that type. You have a metric, you have a B field, and you have a dilaton. So this is the scalar curvature of the metric. This is essentially H square, and that's the kinetic energy for the dilaton. So we have, as I said, a metric, preferably a Riemannian to keep it simple, B field and the dilaton. So H bar is just a combination of a closed triform and D of B. So you recognize the bosonic part of type 2 supergravity with so no fermions and RR fields are omitted. And so what? Well, not necessarily. It would have been if it comes from supergravity, but for purposes of this talk, there is no restriction on dimensions. So what is the motivation for this talk is to understand the generalized Riemannian geometry of this type of effective actions and their quasi-Poisson-Lie duality. In, well, a special case, where P is a principal D bundle, so that's the base manifold. D is a connected Lie group with a quadratic Lie algebra, which means that we have an invariant, at invariant, positive definite pairing on the Lie algebra. And G is a connected closed and Lagrangian subgroup. So Lagrangian means with respect to the pairing on D. Okay, so for simplicity, I will, when coming to the T-duality, restrict myself to the case where M is a point. So the total space is the group D itself. So this means that, well, I will consider no spectators. Okay, so since we would like to understand it from the point of view of generalized geometry of Courant algebraids, so let me maybe recall the definition of a Courant algebraid for you. So what are the data? We have a vector bundle with the total space E and the base manifold M. We have a morphism from the total space to the tangent bundle of M, which is called anchor. We have a fiber-wise metric on the total space. And we have a R bilinear bracket on the sections of the total space, on the sections of the bundle, and the axioms. So the first one is that taking a fixed section and doing the bracket with it, it's a differential operator, so it satisfies the Leibniz rule with respect to multiplication of the second input with the function, which means that you can take the function out of the bracket, but then there is another term. So now you have your anchor, which gives you a vector field. You can apply the vector field to the function and multiply the second input to get a section. The second axiom is that this bracket is a derivation of the bracket. This means that we have Jacobi identity. Then the bracket and pairing are compatible. In contrast to ordinary Lie algebraids, the bracket is not necessarily anti-symmetric. So there is a symmetric part of the bracket, which is controlled in terms of the pairing and the anchor.
This is the
That's the Dörfman bracket, not the Courant. That would be the Dörfman bracket, exactly. So the first example is the kind of canonical one, the exact Courant algebraid, where you consider the Whitney sum of the tangent bundle and the cotangent bundle. Rho is the projection to the first factor, or to the first summand. So the pairing is the canonical one between the forms and the vector fields. And that's the Dorfman bracket. So you see, it's not anti-symmetric. Here you have only one half of the Lie derivative. And you can twist it with the closed tree form. And okay, so there is this classification theorem of Chevera, which says that every exact Courant algebraoid is of that form. So usually people refer then to this tree form as the Chevera class of the exact Courant algebraoid. Okay, since we want to do generalized Riemannian geometry, we need the notion of generalized metric. So one way to define it is to take maximal positive sub-bundle of our total space of the vector bundle defining the Courant algebraoid. And it is the positive sub-bundle, of course, with respect to the Courant algebraoid metric or pairing. Then we can decompose our bundle in two direct sum of this plus sum bundle and its orthogonal complement, which defines us in involution, which just takes value plus as identity on the plus part, minus one identity on the minus part. And this gives us another description of generalized metric. And to bring it in the familiar form, we can use this involution to define a positive definite fiber-wise metric, well, G. Okay, in principle, you can start with any orthogonal vector bundle and it has a generalized metric. And the space on the space of generalized metrics, this orthogonal group acts transitively. So in the case of our exact Courant algebraoid, this V plus subbundle is a graph of a bundle map, which takes sections, vector fields, and produces one forms. And since you can decompose this two tensor into symmetric and anti-symmetric part, it gives you really a Riemannian metric and a B field. So what is a Courant algebraic connection? So one way to introduce Courant algebraic connection is a map from the on the product of space of sections into sections, which if we introduce the standard notation for this map of sections, it is again a derivation with respect to multiplying this section by a function. So you take the function in the front of the covariant derivative, but then you have also this term. Normally you would just act by the vector field. Now you have first take your section and use the anchor to produce a vector field to be able to act on the function. And of course, should be C linear in this phi here to the section with respect to which you do the covariant derivative. And so you ask for it to be compatible with the pairing on your Courant algebraoid, which means that the covariant derivative of your metric on the Courant algebraoid is zero. So as an example, if you think of E as an ordinary vector bundle, and you have an ordinary vector bundle connection on E, you can construct using the anchor Courant algebraic connection. But that's a too restrictive class of connections. We need something more general. You see, here actually that's kind of important thing, that we map the product of the same spaces, of the same spaces of sections. Because of this, we can form a torsion tree form. So the definition is by Gualtieri. So you can mimic the standard definition for the tangent bundle. So you would recognize this piece. But because we... The point is that the Courant bracket, we actually know only how it, according to definitions, since there is no anti-symmetry and we defined only its properties with respect to multiplication in this second input by the function. So it fails to be really a tensor in general. But there is a way to correct it. So this is the term you can add and make it tensorial. And well, then it will be, again, it will be C infinity M linear, skew symmetric. And now you can impose a condition on being torsion free. Now we would like to have an analog of a Levi-Civita connection. So since we have a generalized metric, a notion of a generalized metric, so we say that a Courant algebraic connection is Levi-Civita with respect to the generalized metric. Well, that's the notation. If it preserves this positive definite sub-bundle, so it takes sections here and produces again a section inside it. And we ask also it to be torsion-free in analogy to the ordinary case. So the statement is this space of Levi-Civita connections with respect to fixed generalized metric is non-empty. That's a good point, good news. But there are way too many of them. So these conditions do not fix the Levi-Civita condition uniquely as in the usual case. There is some freedom, which actually will be an advantage, which will follow. Okay, we can take the definition of Hohm and Zwiebach. They had it in the context of double field theory, but actually we can take this and it works for actually arbitrary Courant algebraic. So that's the definition of the curvature tensor. Again, you recognize the expression like in the ordinary case. But again, now you have to add some correction to have it really tensorial. So there is a way to make it a good tensor with all the symmetries you would like to have, also including algebraic Bianchi identity. Well, what is obscure is the geometrical meaning of that. But anyway, it works. Yeah, having the curvature tensor, you can form a generalized Ricci tensor. So as a partial trace, where here you... so this is a basis, like a frame, in your Courant algebraic. And that's the dual one, but you can use the metric. Okay, again, it is symmetric and it is a good tensor. And we say that the connection, a connection is Ricci compatible with the generalized metric if this block, so if you evaluate it in V plus in the first entry and in the minus part in the second entry, it is a zero. So that's the definition of Ricci compatibility of a connection with the generalized metric. And finally, you can define two kinds of scalar curvatures because you have now two metrics. You have the metric on your Courant algebraic, so you can use this to do trace, or you can use your generalized metric to do the trace. Okay, so the final piece of structure is we need to define a divergence. So, well, that's the kind of pretty standard thing, how we define divergence. So again, these are basis of some sections, a frame of your Courant algebra, the dual one. And that's the just the pairing between the space and the dual one. So this is how we define divergence. And the statement is, if you have two Levi-Civita connections with the same divergence, then the Ricci tensors will be the same, and also this this block, which was used to define the Ricci compatibility, will be the same. Okay, so with all this, having introduced all this, we can formulate the following kind of, if you wish, theorem. So on the exact Courant algebraoid with a twisted Dorfman bracket, this generalized metric V plus corresponds to a Riemannian metric G and the B field B. And let us assume that the connection is a Levi-Civita connection with respect to this generalized metric, such that if we compute the divergence as defined here and the divergence with respect to the ordinary Levi-Civita connection, there will be a function such that this equality holds. So if this is the case, we will this connection belongs to that space. So that's the notation for connections which are Levi-Civita connections, and their divergence satisfies this equality for some phi. So that's just the assumptions and how the statement comes. So we include this phi into the background, so it's already denoted suggestively by phi as a dilaton. So if we have G, B, and phi, and such that they satisfy the equations of motion given by the effective action, okay, so the statement is they satisfy the equations of motions if and only if the Ricci scalar is zero and the connection is Ricci compatible with the generalized metric. So recall that this scalar, Ricci scalar, and this another one, which this block, they do not depend on the choice of the connection if there is a dilaton associated with the connection. And there is this remark that everything behaves nicely under the Courant algebraic morphisms. So it's in some way covariant description. So what we can do with that is some kind of, Kaluza-Klein reduction, non-abelian one, where we start with the, where we start with the principal bundle. G is, let's say, compact and has a Killing form. So we denote by GP underline the corresponding adjoint bundle. We assume a connection on our principal bundle. So we think of it as this Eresmann connection, one form on the total space with values in the Lie algebra, with the corresponding curvature f. And what we need is also a tree form on the base manifold. Then we can consider another type of Courant algebraoid, which is a prototype of what people refer to as heterotic Courant algebraoid. Actually, I put pre, I explain it later why it does not be, need to be necessarily Courant algebraic. So we can take Whitney sum of the tangent bundle, cotangent bundle, but in addition we have the adjoint bundle. So again, to make it to Courant algebraic, we need the pairing. So the pairing is again, so it's the canonical one between these two parts. But now on our adjoint bundle, we have a pairing which is induced by the Killing form on the Lie algebra. So that's the piece of the pairing here. Anchor is again the projection to the tangent bundle, and the bracket. So we have seen already the twisted Dorfman bracket on the exact Courant algebraic. So this is one part of the bracket. But this one is mixed with another one, which is this forms naturally a Lie algebraic, which is actually the Atiyah Lie algebraic. So we have a Lie bracket also on this part. So you can combine these two brackets in order to form a Courant algebraic bracket on this heterotic Courant algebraic. And so the point is that you will get the Courant algebraic only if the Pontryagin class is trivial. So if it comes as D of this H0 on the base manifold, which is not necessarily closed. Otherwise, it will be just something which people refer pre-Courant algebraic. So you will have again Jacobi identity, but now it will be up to D of something. Okay, now if you take the definition I introduced for a generalized metric as a maximal positive subbundle, so you can easily figure out what the generalized metric will be. It will have again, well, no surprise, it will be again a metric, a B field, but now there will be also the piece coming from this extra bundle here. It will be just one form with values in the adjoint bundle. Now we can consider effective action of this type, which people sometimes refer as Einstein-Young-Mills gravity. So again, you have the scalar curvature of your Riemannian connection. You have a Young-Mills part, where the F prime is formed out of your connection and this extra piece defining the generalized action. So actually, if you wish, you can combine A and theta in a new connection. And H bar again will be some combination of D of B, and there will be also another part defined by in terms of H0 and F and theta. And yeah, okay, to be sure, just put a cosmological constant also into it. So if you think of a principal bundle, which is a Whitney sum of principal bundles of a Young-Mills and the spin one, so in case the Young-Mills will have structure group SO32 or E8 times E8, and the spin will be spin 91, that's what you have in the heterotic supergravity. And this condition on the tree form H0, which I had before, well, or on the first Pontryagin class, if you wish, this you recognize as the anomaly cancellation condition via inflow in the Green-Schwarz mechanism. Oh yes, but but as I said, I neglect or charges from the beginning. Yeah, it's a part. Yes, exactly. Okay. It would be interesting to know how to formulate this in the language in geometry of Courant algebra. Yeah, I don't know, but maybe Friedrich can tell you. Okay. Okay. So the general claim is that every such heterotic Courant algebra can be obtained by a kind of reduction from the exact one which is on the total space of your principal bundle. With the tree form, which is a pullback of a tree form from the base manifold, not necessarily closed, and the Chern-Simons. I will not go into details how this reduction works, but it's kind of a natural thing. If you know how symplectic reduction works, it's an analog in the world of Courant algebraids. So if you start with a G-invariant generalized metric on your total space of your principal bundle and you do the reduction, you can obtain a generalized metric on your reduced one. So starting with a G and B upstairs, you get, after reduction, a generalized metric on the reduced bundle. And the proposition is that If your Dilaton field now on the total space comes from a Dilaton field on the base space, just by pullback, then you can find a connection on this exact Courant algebraid on the total space and one on the reduced Courant algebraid, such that this one the primed is a reduction of the unprime one under this Courant algebraic reduction, and that this connection on the total space is Ricci compatible with generalized metric on the total space is equivalent to this reduced one being compatible with the reduced generalized metric. And there is also a relation between the scalar curvatures. So this is the relation of the scalar curvatures. The scalar curvature on the total space is the pullback of the curvature on the base space, and there is this extra piece, which is the 1/6 of the dimension of.
So you don't see any Dilaton
shift? Yes, you will. Yeah, you will see it. Well, this comes in the duality, the Dilaton shift, right? You mean? Okay, here you, no, here is just the pullback, if you, yeah. It's just
the pullback. You're integrating out if you think of a quotient by gauging and integrating out the gauge, you also move this way from whatever coefficients there you
Oh, I don't know. Here the difference is this this piece which you, well, shift of the cosmological constant. That's of the cosmological constant. No, it's a different thing, yes.
You know that duality can be thought of as two different quotients.
Yes, but then you see the Dilaton shift. That's the point. Then you see the Dilaton.
Yeah, but there it's really, but there the Dilaton shift is really just coming from the quotient.
Okay. The point is that you have a freedom in this choosing the. I will come to that. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. You have to shift actually. Yeah. Okay. You have here a freedom. You have which results, and then you have to do two different choices if you different to two different. Okay, So what is the claim? The claim is that if I have a generalized metric and a dilaton on the total space of a principal bundle and the background on the base space, sorry, on the reduced one, which are related via this construction, and you relate well exactly in this way the cosmological constants, then the equations of motions for this heterotic effective action and for the one I started with are the same, are equivalent. Yeah, so how Poisson-Liti duality works, it's an application of all that. So, well, actually, as you know well, goes back to Klimchik and Chevera. And then Chevera more recently interpreted it in terms of algebra of Courant, in geometry of Courant algebraids. So, and as I said, I will here, for simplicity, consider just the case where my principal bundle is a group, Lie group itself. So the simple setting is that we start with the Manning pair of Lie algebras. So we have a Lie algebra D, which is a quadratic Lie algebra. So it means has a pairing, which is ad-invariant and non-degenerate. And it has a Lie bracket. And the Lagrangian subalgebra. And we assume that we have a pair of Lie groups which integrate this two Lie algebras, this Manning pair, such that G is a closed subgroup. Now, yeah, we have our principal bundle we start with. In this case, it, as I said, in the total space is just the group D itself, so our base space will be point. And since G is a subgroup, a closed one, also this acts principally on D, so that's the base space for D thought as a principal G bundle now. Now we have the Courant algebraid on the total space on the group D, which is the exact one where the tree form is just the Chern-Simons formed out of the Cartan left invariant Maurer-Cartan form. And then we can do symplectic reduction with respect to the D action, which in this case, since we are over point, so what we get is just our quadratic Lie algebra. So that's the Lie algebraic pairing, that's the Lie algebraic bracket, and the target is trivial. We are over the point. But then we can also do the reduction here. And what we obtain, so the first part you can see immediately, you just do the trivialization of the, let's say, tangent and cotangent bundle with respect to the, let's say, left invariant vector field. So what you obtain is this coset space cross D itself, and a little work is to show that this is really an exact one. So you have an anchor which is given by the, you have still the left action of the Lie algebra on your coset space. So this is the dressing action, so this gives you the anchor. And you have a bracket and pairing, and these are just the fiber-wise extensions from the pairing and bracket on D. Now, how the Poisson-Liti duality was introduced in, well, it was introduced for sigma models. And the idea is that you choose a generalized metric in your reduced Courant algebraid, in the heterotic one, which is just the Lie algebra itself. So you just choose a maximal positive definite subspace in your Lie algebra. You have your quadratic pairing. And you produce one on on this one, which you get via reduction with respect to D. Well, that's simple because this is just N cross D. So once you have a generalized metric on D itself, then you have it here. So this is how you get a generalized metric on this reduced Courant algebraoid. And it has some, since it is exact, it has some Chevera class, which I can tell you the formula, exact one, if you were interested later. Now, this corresponds to a pair of a metric of a B field, and now you can consider the sigma models with the metric G with the B field B and with the Vesemino-Witten term, which is given by the Chevera class of this exact Courant algebraoid, and the target is in this cosine space of the sigma model. And then proposition or theorem by Chevera says that once, if you fix this generalized metric in your Lie algebra D, then all sigma models, this means for any choice of a Lagrangian subgroup, are equivalent. So in particular, if you take a Mannian triple, so if you take a complement in D of G, which is also a Lie algebra, if you are in that, if you can do that in this position, such that they integrate, then you have a plus on Lie duality of the corresponding sigma models, which means that, you can switch between G and G dual. It's just a classical duality. Yes, that's classical duality. Now, okay, what we would like to do is to work, find out how this works for effective actions. So for this, we need to know what to do with the dilaton. And one way to do is using the Levi-Civita connections. So what we can do, we can mimic just what Chevera and Klimczyk did for generalized metric for the dilaton. So we can fix a Levi-Civita connection on our Courant algebraoid, you remember, over the point with respect to our generalized metric, which was a positive definite subspace of the Lie algebra D. And one can find the Levi-Civita connection in this exact Courant algebraoid, which we obtained by reducing with respect of G with the corresponding generalized metric. And by construction, we will get the same scalar curvatures. And okay, so the statement is that again, if we started here with Ricci compatible one, we will obtain here also a Ricci compatible one. Well, there is still no dilaton, but for dilaton to have a dilaton, we have to assume that our Lie algebra G is unimodular. So this means that if you take any Lie algebra element and compute the trace of the adjoint of the matrix of the adjoint action, you get zero. Then you can ask for this connection you start with to be a divergence free. And if you can choose such one, you will obtain a connection here, which will have a dilaton, so which will be in this space. And you can find an explicit expression for the dilaton. And indeed, you can find a divergence-free connection here. And this expression, well, will contain will explicitly depend on, of course, on your generalized metric GB, and on the quasi-Poisson structure on your coset space. Naturally, on the coset space, if you start with the Drinfeld double, you have quasi-Poisson structure. Poisson Lie structure. And also, of course, somehow the adjoint action of the dressing action will also enter the formula in some way. And this will be unique up to an additive constant. So in the case, if you have a Manin triple, you obtain the formulas from 2002, from some papers of Ricard von Unge, which were obtained by some path integral arguments. Yeah, in particular, yes. Yes. It's kind of special in Drinfeld triple, right?
It's a special case.
Yes, it's a special case. And in general, you have a plurality, T plurality. So so what is the result? Is the theorem is that your background GB and the dilaton satisfy the equations of motion on E on this coset D over G, if and only if. The connection you started with on this Courant algebraoid on the Lie algebra itself is Levi-Civita, of course, is Ricci compatible with the generalized metric, and if this scalar curvature is zero. So this means that you can reduce your equations of motions on N to algebraic equations. Just algebraic equations for this subspace, which defines you the generalized metric on the Lie algebra B. And so starting solving this, they will provide you solutions of the equations of motions on M for any choice of a Lagrangian subgroup. So that's kind of a result. And what is the outlook? Of course, would be interesting to find some explicit solutions for these algebraic equations. It's not completely trivial to have really interesting cases. So we are working on that. Another one is to formulate the topological t-duality in this Lie-Poisson framework, and in terms of algebra, of geometry of Courant algebraoids, and understand and relate to the recent approach of Chevera and Wallach. So they have work which is kind of similar to that. But looks a bit different. They don't use connections at all. But they know how to include Ramon-Ramon fields. So hopefully all this is coming soon. So I hope, that's...
Any questions for Brano? Yes, another question, Martin. Other questions then, Martin? So presumably this is very general. I mean, you can do it for other effective actions, right?
Yeah. Hopefully, yes, but these are two. This Courant algebra is the exact one, and the heterotic ones, these are the ones which are well understood. So, luckily enough, they lead to things we know. Okay. And they contain.
So, other effective actions might use constructions that don't exist, maybe?
I don't know. So these notions of generalized metric and the connection and all that I used, it's very general. This can be defined for any Courant algebraoid. Yep. Yes. But you see, this abstract definition, for example, of a generalized metric as a positive definite sub-bundle, it gives you G and B, or G and B and this extra one form, in these cases I mentioned, in the exact one and in the heterotic. So, first of all, you would have to understand what kind of fields you can associate it for a general Courant algebra to a generalized metric.
Sure.
And all these kind of things can be kind of interesting, yes.
When you talk about explicit solutions, so if you look at the case of just not the simple case, non-abelian,
yes,
T-duality.
Yeah, that works. We have some solutions. I can show you. I can show you what these solutions.
Okay, very good. Other questions for Brano? Okay, let's thank Brano again.